Hey Roots family, this week we're continuing in our teaching series entitled The Church as Forged Family. In this series, we're exploring what the church is meant to be and not what we've often encountered it as. The church Jesus established was always meant to be an inclusive and diverse family of faith centered on allegiance to Jesus as King. But along the way, the church has often become little more than an institution bent on self-preservation, or an exclusive and bureaucratic social club. So, we want to rediscover the radical nature of the church and recapture its spirit. However, as beautiful as the vision of church as family is, it may also conjure painful associations for many of us. Not everyone has the same positive feelings about the concept of family. This could be because of the dysfunction of our families of origin, or it could be due to the way that family has been used by leaders in our lives in ways that were abusive. Family is such a powerful concept that those who only wish to control others could wield it as a weapon. Like the villain from one of my favorite childhood movies, Kurt, of Mondo Burger.
People, I'm fully stoked about being in charge of every single one of you. Within 2 years, Mondo Burger is going to be the biggest burger chain on this planet. Oh yeah. First, we gotta beat out our big competition across the street, Good Burger. From now on, your life is Mondo Burger. You can forget about your friends. You can forget about your family. Because Kurt is now both your mother and your father.
Kurt must look awfully strange, naked.
Who said that? Who talked while Kurt was talking?
It was him. He uttered something.
Well, I should have known.
Oh, I'm sorry I uttered.
You think you're funny, don't you, bro? You know what? Mondo Burger, there are no comedians. You mess with Kurt and you go into the grinder.
Okay, now this grinder of yours, is it a real grinder or is it some kind of a metaphor?
That's it! You're gone! Adios, TKO, historical.
Wait. I won't be funny no more, see?
Security!
You ain't got to bring the man down here. What is that? Kurt, come on, please. I need this job.
Take out the trash.
Trash? Oh, now look at here.
So get this loser out of my face.
Loser? Oh, now you about to push me a little too far.
You want a piece of me?
Yeah, extra crispy, please. I'll see you lucky you brought your friends down here. Hey, man, is this something necessary? Kurt, please, I need this job.
I use this funny clip to intentionally lighten the mood a bit, since today's message could be a bit heavy. And I also want to encourage you to take all the space and time that you need to process this message, or reach out to Pastor Oshita or myself if you need somebody to talk to. In this message, I want to make space for those of us for whom family has troubling connotations. And I want to acknowledge that even a good thing like family has a dark side. We need to be able to identify unhealthy ways of being family, so that we don't replicate them. And we also want to illuminate how our identities are formed in relationships. Obviously, much more could be said than what will be said in this brief message, so consider this the start of an ongoing dialogue that we'll be having as a community. But before we dive into our main text, let's pray for the Spirit's work of illumination. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, I'm so grateful that you're the one who joins us to Christ and renews our whole being. But not only that, you're also the one who unites us with one another in this new human family that we call church. Would you open our eyes to the ways that you are at work among us, making us family? And would you show us the forces that seek to keep us divided? Shine your light of illumination on the scriptures we will hear today, we pray. And may the words of my lips and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. If you have your own translation of the New Testament, I invite you to turn in it to the letter of Galatians, chapter 2. Or you can follow along with me. I'll be reading from the NIV, starting in verse 11. When Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For before certain men came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they arrived, he began to draw back and separate himself from the Gentiles because he was afraid of those who belonged to the circumcision group. The other Jews joined him in his hypocrisy, so that by their hypocrisy, even Barnabas was led astray. When I saw that they were not acting in line with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in front of them all, "You are a Jew, yet you live like a Gentile and not like a Jew. How is it then that you force Gentiles to follow Jewish customs? We who are Jews by birth and not sinful Gentiles know that a person is not justified by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Because by the works of the law, no one will be justified. But if, in seeking to be justified in Christ, we Jews find ourselves also among the sinners, doesn't that mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, then I really would be a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law, so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, I have a big problem with how this passage is often interpreted in modern Western contexts. Going back to at least the Reformation, modern Westerners have made this passage about how God's grace is opposed to following rules. There's often an interpretation of this passage that goes like this: God's grace is free and requires nothing. You don't have to follow any rules or be a good person. God's grace is unconditional. And that's why Paul says he died to the law, so that you and I don't have to live by the law anymore. Isn't that great news? That's actually not what's going on in this passage at all. This passage is about the creation of a new family, a family that isn't defined by ethnicity or culture or bloodlines. This passage is about the gathering of people, both Jewish and non-Jewish people, aka Gentiles, who have all given their faith, or better yet, their allegiance, to Jesus as their king. Some of these Jesus disciples are Jewish and have continued to follow the Torah commandments in at least three major ways. Number one, circumcision. This was a covenantal sign given to Abraham that set apart Abraham's family members from all the other people groups of the world. The family of the circumcision were in special covenantal relationship to God by God's own choice, not because of anything they did to deserve it. Number two, by ceasing from work on Saturdays to honor God, aka keeping Sabbath. This was a command God gave Israel that points towards God's eternal rest into which God invites us all. This isn't about taking a day off, even though that's a good thing to do. It's about honoring God and trusting God with our bodies and with our lives. The third one is about abstaining from foods that God prohibited Israelites from eating, aka keeping kosher. This is also about honoring God with one's body. So, some of the Jesus disciples in the region that Paul is talking about, Antioch, were Jewish and kept the Torah commands given to Israel. But by this time, Paul has been preaching the gospel of God's kingdom breaking into the world through Jesus Christ all throughout the Mediterranean world. And this opening up a new way of salvation to all people through Jesus, not just Jewish people. So, the church in Antioch was made up of Jewish Jesus disciples and Gentile Jesus disciples. And the Gentile Jesus disciples didn't necessarily keep the Torah commands given to Israel because they weren't Israelites. What Paul isn't saying here is that the commands of the Torah are now evil commands. And Paul isn't saying that Jewish Jesus disciples should stop keeping those commands. What Paul is saying is that keeping those commands no longer sets apart the people of God as God's family. the new covenant marker of inclusion into God's family is allegiance to Jesus. Everyone who is baptized into allegiance to Jesus is one new human family, regardless of ethnicity, culture, etc., including ethnic and cultural practices that are from commands given to Israel by God. This means allegiance to Jesus, not circumcision, not keeping Sabbath, not keeping kosher, is what makes us the family of God. And that's good news. In this passage, Cephas, aka Peter, he knew this. He had this truth revealed to him in a vision that resulted in him baptizing an entire household of a Roman centurion, children and all. And he baptized them into the body of the Messiah, Jesus. According to Acts, this is what Peter says after that whole thing goes down. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. Peter knew that the gospel means that Gentile Jesus disciples are now included into the family of God. That was exclusively for Jewish people up until that point. But Peter has a problem that we're well aware of from reading the Gospels. Peter often caves to peer pressure. Like in the Gospels, when we read that Peter denied Jesus on the night that he was being crucified, when he was asked merely if he knew Jesus. The same Peter who boldly announced that he would die for Jesus instead disowned Jesus when a young girl questioned him about his allegiance. And this is Peter's problem again in this passage. Some Jewish men have come from James, the text says, which probably means from Jerusalem, where tradition holds that James, the brother of Jesus, was the first leader of the church there. And these Jewish men from Jerusalem would have probably shamed Peter for sharing table fellowship with quote-unquote Gentile sinners. So Peter withdraws from them. And in so doing, even Barnabas, who has been with Paul, seeing the Holy Spirit given to Gentiles all throughout the Roman world, even he is led astray and withdraws from the Gentiles too. And this deeply offends Paul, and it should offend us too, because if the gospel doesn't unite us across cultural and ethnic divisions, then the good news of Jesus as Lord of all, and not just Jewish people, is a lie. Or, as Paul puts it, I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. Generations of Protestants have applied this verse very individualistically, thinking it means something like, I don't have to follow any rules because I've been given God's grace unconditionally. But that's not what Paul is talking about here. Paul is talking about Jewish Jesus disciples sharing table fellowship with Gentile Jesus disciples. The righteousness he's talking about here isn't personal moral purity. It's the right relationship, the justice, the harmony, the shalom that has been renewed by Jesus and in Jesus. Not just between people and God, but also between people groups who have been historically divided. The grace of God in this context is the gift of God that unites us into one family, the gift that makes us the diverse body of Christ. And if that grace and that righteousness has already been established by keeping the commands of the Torah, well then Jesus' life, ministry, teachings, healings, death, resurrection, and ascension was all for nothing. But we know it wasn't. Jesus' life opens up the way to the world renewed in shalom. A just world, an inclusive family. But this episode in the life of the early church dramatically shows us that there are powerful forces that will continue to seek to divide us. Even apostles like Peter and Barnabas, who had witnessed firsthand God's power to engraft Gentiles into the church, were led astray by these forces. If you haven't already heard me recommend this book, fair warning, you'll probably hear me recommend it many times in the future. Dr. Christina Cleveland is a social psychologist, an expert on group dynamics and how they function, how they keep us divided. She wrote a fantastic book that, in my opinion, has stood the test of time. It's called Disunity in Christ, uncovering the hidden forces that keep us apart. Now, I won't spoil the book for you. Anyways, there's too many important insights to include in this brief message. So I want to highlight just one of her insights that has stuck with me and helped me perhaps the most. It's the power of common in-group identity. Nothing unifies people more effectively than common in-group identity. You want to make a group of strangers into a team? Give them a common identity. Now you're not just a bunch of athletes, you're the Tigers. I'll even give you an example from my life. When I was 16 and was sent to a boot camp for high-risk teenagers run by the National Guard, I was placed in a group of 50 other teenagers, most of whom, almost all of whom, were gang involved. We were put in tiny dorm rooms in a crowded barracks. Now, how did our drill sergeants keep all these rival gang members from killing each other? Easy. They gave us a common group identity. On the wall of our barracks was a huge mural of that famous image of soldiers working together to raise an American flag in Iwo Jima. Our drill sergeants told us that that platoon that worked together to raise that flag were called the Bone Crushers, a fact that I have never confirmed. And now our team of 50 were the Bone Crushers too. So every day when we marched, when we ran in formation, we sang cadences together and we shouted our collective identity, Bone Crushers! This common identity that was likely chosen at random united rival gang members who would have otherwise tried to kill each other. The same goes for our collective identity as the body of Christ. When we were baptized into Christ, we clothed ourselves with Christ, and the new creation has been revealed in us. Our new identity supersedes all other identities. Our allegiance to Christ supersedes all other allegiances. But this is precisely where the concept of family as a common group identity, because it is so powerful, can be abused. This is how Kurt from Mondo Burger can demand that his employees forget about their friends, forget about their family, because their life is now Mondo Burger. How many of our employers have, in subtler terms, said basically the same thing? Here at fill-in-the-blank company, we're not just a ditch-digging company, we're a family. I'll never forget when I started working at Apple Retail part-time when I was in seminary in Boston. We were shown these training videos with employees giving dramatic personal testimonies about how Apple had transformed their lives. People who had just been hired at the same time as me were watching the same videos as me and crying real tears. That's when I was like, this is really a cult. The concept of family can have a dark side because controlling people have abused this concept and have wielded it like a weapon. Sometimes it's been used to silence dissent. Sometimes it's been used to cover up abuses. Sometimes it's simply been used to manipulate people. If we're going to avoid these pitfalls, we have to know how to recognize them and neutralize them. So, in the brief time that I have left, I want to talk about this concept of differentiation as a healthy and necessary part of being family, the kind of family that the church is, and the kind of family that Roots is becoming. Steve Cuss is the author of Managing Leadership Anxiety, Yours and Theirs, and he specializes in the intersection of Christian theology and what's been called family systems theory, pioneered by a guy named Murray Bowen. He recently wrote this, "Differentiation is clarity on where you end and the other begins. The two opposites are indifference and enmeshment. Healthy space, clarity of values, while staying connected to another. Differentiated people can manage their reactivity and become a non-anxious presence." Healthy differentiation is a necessary part of being a non-anxious part of a family system. One of the ways that family can be abused is when someone wields it as a weapon of erasure. What I mean by this is when someone forces you to abandon your particular identities in order to adopt the identity of a family member. A famous example of this that I've cited several times before is when Native American theologian Dr. Richard Twiss was a brand new follower of Jesus, and he was struggling to understand the place of his native identity and his cultural practices and traditions as a member of the body of Christ. So he went to a trusted pastor for counsel. And that pastor happened to be white and happened to also be unaware of the very dynamics that we're talking about. And he read the young Richard Twiss a portion of Galatians 3:28. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, for we are all one in Christ. And he unfortunately said to Richard Twiss, "Don't worry about being an Indian, Richard. Just be like us." Dr. Twiss then spent many years denying his cultural and ethnic identity, trying to assimilate into Western white Christian culture, only to find that he'd lost a beautiful and precious gift that God had given him in his native identity. His book, One Church, Many Tribes, is all about the journey that God led him on to reclaim that identity. Another way that the concept of family can be abused is to silence dissent. Like when Kurt bullies Kenan Thompson's character, Dexter, into submission. People in unhealthy churches have been told they can't have their own opinions or speak up when they disagree, because that's not how family works. But that's a manipulative tactic. I want you to know that as family, we want you to have your own opinions. We want you to speak up. We can't be a healthy family without that. And I've personally been part of churches where I was silenced with concepts like we're family, and it felt like death. So I never want you to feel that way. Differentiation is also an important part of facilitating empathy for one another rather than stifling it. Remember those two ditches on either side of differentiation: indifference and enmeshment. Without differentiation, we will either not recognize the needs of others, aka indifference, or not recognize the needs of others as different from our own needs, enmeshment. And neither of those facilitates true empathy. As Chuck DeGroat writes, empathy doesn't demand that we lose ourselves, our emotions, thoughts, in another. Don't buy that mischaracterization. We can be both connected to and differentiated from at the same time. That's healthy, mature adulthood. In fact, differentiation makes real empathy possible. When it comes to the body of Christ, when we're baptized into Christ, we take on a new identity. A new identity that bridges divisions that the corrupt systems of the world have used to divide and conquer us. But this new identity doesn't erase our other identities. It brings those identities under the lordship of Christ so that they can be perfected in holiness and wholeness. Paul, for example, never ceases to be a Jewish man, even though he becomes an apostle of Christ. He never once denies those identities. In fact, he makes it a point that he's proud of his Jewish identity. However, he also makes his Jewish identity and his male identity bow down to Jesus. Jesus is now his Lord, and his highest allegiance is to Christ. I love how Dr. Christina Cleveland captures this in Disunity in Christ. She writes this: "The idea of a common in-group identity that trumps all subordinate identities might seem to suggest we should all relinquish our cultural identities and ignore our cultural differences. However, to do this would violate the metaphor of the body of Christ, in which each group expresses its unique function in coordination with other groups and in submission to the head, Jesus Christ." You see, the very metaphor of being the body of Christ means that we have to have distinction. We have to have diversity. Otherwise, the body can't function. We can't all be hands, or the body can't walk. We can't all be eyes, or the body can't hear. But all the diverse parts are united in one body so that we can work together. Finally, another way that the concept of family can be abused is by creating an exclusivity and gatekeeping, like Kurt pitting Mondo Burger against Good Burger. Sometimes family has been weaponized to create an us versus them kind of effect. But this is precisely the opposite of how Paul picks up the concept of family from the life and teachings of Jesus. Paul rebukes Peter precisely for this kind of thinking. The family of God isn't a new division, it's an open door of inclusion. In fact, for Paul, Jesus' family is an adoptive family, not one that relies on blood relation. Paul pleads with the church in Galatia to not redraw the dividing lines around circumcision, but to see that Jesus has made himself the center to which all people are drawn. A center-set family, not a bounded-set family. He writes this, "But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, the spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. You are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also an heir." There are no insiders and outsiders in the body of Christ, because to be in the body of Christ means to recognize that we've all been adopted by God's grace, the same grace that is available to all people. Sisters and brothers, and that's who you are to me. I believe God is making roots into this kind of forged family, one that does not erase or dishonor our particular identities, but joins them together in allegiance to Jesus. A family that is open to everyone, like a banqueting table with an infinite number of extension leaves.
Just for some, but for everyone.